Now for the final segment of the Tale of Moses, this part one remember more of than the rest. I remember that it was at this time as Moses was leaving with the Hebrews that the Pharaoh Ramses had called in his scribes and they proposed bringing in Set to resurrect his son. When I told him that it was not possible, in grief he erupted in anger and went after Moses and the Hebrews with a great vengeance in his heart. Now it does not mention this in the Bible, but there were many times that Apollyon had appeared before the armies of the Pharaoh warning him not to pursue Moses. Three times, if I remember correctly, the flaming column of fire appeared before the Pharaoh and his men. Each time the Pharaoh had refused to heed the warning of both his own priests and Apollyon. Switching the focus to Moses, while they were traveling across the desert, God had appeared and was giving him instruction through his dreams. He knew of the advancing army of the Pharaoh and was directing Moses accordingly. As they approached the Red Sea, I remember the Pharaoh's armies came upon the horizon behind them through the mountain pass. The Hebrews began to panic, knowing not what to do. As they began to turn against Moses, blaming him for bringing them to their doom, he stopped and looked up into the sky in prayer to be filled with the Lord so that he might guide them to safety.
Lord, I cannot believe this is the end you planned for us.
Moses stood, as if under a trance, walked to the edge of the embankment and rose his staff to the skies and struck the ground. I remember two large angels, each the size of a mountain, coming down into the seas and the seas parting, each side of the waters being held in place by the wingspan of these two huge angels. With that, Moses collapsed and weak for some reason. Aaron and his close friend Jacob picked Moses up and urged him to walk. They placed him in the back of a donkey-pulled cart and raced into the parted waters. At first, none of the horses or mules that carried their supplies wanted to go into the path across the seas and had to leave some of them behind. I remember one man slew his own mule, not for being stubborn but so that the Egyptians would not claim him as theirs. About a quarter of the way across, Moses awoke and saw the advancing army of the Pharaoh standing at the edge, refusing to enter. Moses openly prayed to God to stop them from crossing, and the image of the burning bush appeared for all to see. And spoke, but not in a booming voice, but gentle like the breeze of the wind, and said, "Yes, my chosen children, I am the God who Moses spoke to. It is I who has commanded him to deliver you from out of Egypt. Fear not, for I shall not let them pass until you reach the other side, but you must hurry." And the flaming bush then whirled into fury of wind and took the shape of a flaming tornado as it scurried back to the entrance to the passage where the Pharaoh's armies still stood. The Pharaoh withheld their pursuit, knowing that it was a trap and the waters would come crashing down as soon as they tried to pursue them. Now a flaming twister of fire with glaring eyes stared down at him, and fear was within all their hearts. "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the birth and death of all things upon this world, the Most High and one true God, and you, Pharaoh, and your men shall not pass." And there it stayed like a pillar-like wall of flames until they had reached the other side of the embankment. Everyone was helping one another, and no man or child was left behind. They ensured all had gotten across, and Moses was the last to come up. As soon as his feet touched the other side, the pillar of God's wrath turned his eyes to the Pharaoh and said, "Pursue the desire in your heart, Pharaoh, and it shall cost you your life and all your men's lives as well." Then the flaming tornado dissipated, and a general of the Pharaoh looked back, and the Pharaoh gave the command to pursue. The commanders began whipping not the horses but their men, commanding them to push forward or be executed on the spot. Reluctantly they pressed on. Moses stood and watched the approaching army with sadness in his heart. Aaron begged him to continue fleeing, for they soon would reach the other side. Moses hung his head low, for while the Holy Spirit dwelled in him when he parted the seas, the Lord revealed to him what he was to do. He lingered on top of the rock on the other side, hoping to dissuade the troops from advancing in order to display the obvious repercussions if they pursued, but it did no good. When Moses saw there was no hope in saving them, he rose his staff in the air once again, just as the Holy Spirit had instructed him to, and struck the stone beneath his feet, and the two giant angels withdrew their wings that held back the waters and let it come crashing back down, killing the Pharaoh and his army. Some of the Hebrews proclaimed, "What kind of God has such power?" And Moses said, "The one true God does. He is the maker of all things. Now come, for he awaits us at Mount Hebron, where he shall deliver us into the promised land, where he says all the children of our generations shall live until his kingdom does come down from the heavens to earth." And off they went towards the mountain God had instructed Moses to bring them to. Now along the way Aaron had begun to become filled with feelings of jealousy as some of the Hebrews began making comments as they traveled asking why is it that he must be the only one to speak to the God of their people. So Aaron approached Moses one day with a mixed feelings of jealousy and fear for Moses' safety as he began to see treachery in some of their eyes. He asked Moses if he may ask God to give him the opportunity to speak his will to the people like Moses, but Moses declined, saying that he was chosen for this path and no other. Later again Aaron approached Moses and asked him, and Moses said he would ask and let him know. That night as the Lord came to Moses in a dream, God had spoken first before he could and said, I know what you are going to ask on behalf of your brother, but no, I have chosen you to be the vessel of my will upon earth, and you alone must carry out this task. For I designed your destiny to fulfill this task, and only you can achieve success. The next morning Moses brought God's answer to Aaron, who seemed greatly saddened by this, and he said, I only seek the chance to prove myself to be worthy before the God of my people, but also because I fear for your safety. There are some who speak in hushed words that you will one day become like the Pharaoh with so much power and responsibility as the only vessel through which he works. They speak of betrayal, but they fear the wrath of God if they do. Moses saw the sincerity in his brother's heart and put his hand upon his shoulder and smiled, we shall see about that, my brother. The next night when God came to Moses and Moses explained the situation, and God reluctantly said, very well, go to Aaron and tell him that the next night I shall come to him in his dreams and give him instruction as to my will for him to perform, but know this, Moses, I created all things from beginning to end, and it is by this that I tell you he is doomed to fail in these tasks I shall give him, so expect nothing less than that. And when it does come to pass, you must turn your back upon him and not reveal that you knew of his failure, for if you do, it will unravel the works of many men to come. Moses went first thing in the morning when he awoke and told Aaron of what was to happen, and surprisingly Aaron felt scared. He did not think that this would come to pass. That night Aaron slept and Gabriel came to him in his sleep and said, awaken Aaron, brother of Moses, for the Most Holy of Holies is expecting your audience before him. Aaron sat straight up and was startled by the loud voice, then looked back and saw he still slept in his bed. How can this be? You must be sent by the God of my people, the one Moses speaks of, Yahweh. Gabriel looked at Moses with a pleasant smile upon his baby soft face and cheeky dimples and said, yes, it is he who is called I Am that has sent me to bring you to him. Now come, worry not about your body, it shall sleep while you are tending to your task. Up they rose above the earth and skies and stars and into the ethereal light of heaven beyond creation. Aaron looked back and saw the massive being of God compared to all he knew and ever could in gain what could be. There he stood before the Almighty, who spoke and said with a rumbling voice of a thousand storms whose face he could not look upon. Aaron, brother of Moses, you have asked to be given a chance to prove yourself worthy before me. By the request of my vessel who will carry my will to mankind, I have chosen these tasks for you to perform. You shall be the bearer of my tabernacle upon the earth, the high priest who shall build my temple that shall house the altar of sacrifice to offer prayer to me. Know the measurements to which you shall build my temple, its width and its length. These measurements will be molded by my works as it is commanded, that as it is above, so too shall it be below. See the wisdom in these words, that what takes place within the heavens, so too shall it take a place upon the earth. The ways the water flows down river is similar to the way each of your lives move through the rising and setting of the days, and as those days come and go, as too do your lives come and go throughout eternity. See and hear the wisdom of these words, and let it be noted that all things occur as I have commanded them to occur, and these things are by my design, for I am the one true God and creator of all that is. So see and hear these words and know that it is wisdom, so it is written, so must it be done. Know that the measurements of the temple must be in proportion to that which is in heaven, for your life upon this world is fashioned one the same way, like a box inside of another larger box and another. So thus my temple which will house my altar shall be made, precisely measured so in scale to that of the heavens. Do know that my altar shall be designed by the works of the priest who uses it proportion in the fashion of my temple, but is instead a display of the priest's works in my name, and the size of the altar shall be to scale of that priest's works within creation and its effects it has had upon it. Now see and hear the wisdom in these words, that the offerings given to be burnt upon the altar shall be a representation of my enemies who stand against me and are defeated by the glory of the one true God. Those who rise to speak against my name, those who seek to bring suffering upon those who find favor in my eyes, and those who seek to destroy that which I have made in spite of me. These enemies and their ways shall be represented in such behaviors and symbolized by the livestock and animals around you. Those which display the characteristics of my enemies are those who will be accepted as offerings upon the altar. Only those who have stood against my enemies by my side in defense of my name shall be worthy to consume of the sacrificial offering, which a portion shall be put aside for them. All other offerings shall be burnt in the cleansing fire which breaks down that which I build and sends it back to me to be made again. For creation, life, and my presence are forever and eternal throughout all that is. Together they are the eternal continuity that is the sum of my works. Now go forth, Aaron, and take with you thy rod and thy chisel, and begin to build my tabernacle. You shall return before me again until I have taught you all that is to be known of your duties. And with that Aaron awoke with his mind clear of the tasks to be done.